within the very short break. So I'm going to report on a study that we had back in November following the discovery of Oumuamua by Karen Mitch and team. And this triggered this workshop with the KISS program, the KISS Institute for Space Studies. And basically, we want to understand how we can explore these once-in-a-lifetime objects, and which we call fantastic targets. And so we explored how to find them. So I think I'm speaking to the choir when I say that these are very important scientific targets. And there are three types. There are the long-period comets, the Oort cloud comets, that have, we think, preserved the volatiles from their origin. And so they bring very fundamental information on the characteristic of the early solar system. There are the Manx comets, which have been recently discovered by Karen Mitch and team. These are comets with no tail or a very faint tail. And Karen thinks that these are relics from the very early solar system, and they are witnesses of big rearrangement of the solar system, for example, the Grand Tack. That threw out very far away, that took material from the inner solar system and threw it very far away. And now they are coming back from the Kuiper Belt or even the Oort cloud. And then there are the interstellar objects. And we have only a sample of one. So we have to work around what that sample is telling us and what it means for future exploration. So there have been multiple origins suggested for the ISOs, but I think the leading origin that has been pushed by Sean Raymond and colleagues is that these are planetesimals or comets, Kuiper Belt objects, ejected from other solar systems. There have been other origins, like maybe there are big fragments of planets that were ejected by a catastrophic disruption. And so we need to visit them just to be sure. Yeah, it is estimated that at this time there is at least one 100-meter large ISO present within 1 AU from the sun, but they can be detected because they are too faint. So we think there are going to be more targets. So the science at long-period objects is going to be the regular, you know, basic physical properties, the mass, the shape, dynamical properties. Very difficult to get the mass and to perform gravity science because generally these bodies are either too small and/or the outgassing introduces non-gravitational forces that make that measurement very difficult to accomplish. We want to have compositional information from the surface, the coma, the dust, the organics. What came out of the study is that in situ remote sensing is maybe sufficient, but what colleagues would like to do is perform mass spectroscopy and the spectroscopy. And then getting information about internal structure is also challenging. It requires very high resolution imaging and good gravity data. And then we want to do morphology pictures, all possible measurements if we have an opportunity to observe and to explore these objects. So the science motivations led to that study. And so we co-organized, so Karen Mitch, Sun Chong from Caltech, and myself were co-organizers, but we have a very cool team. And I think there are people from this group, there is Chris, Marguerite, Christine, and I think others were participating. It was very nice, very good weather in November. The report will be released in June, so I'm just going to present a few preliminary findings. So exploring long-period objects, once-in-a-lifetime objects, is very challenging. And the most problematic aspect is the relative velocity between 35 to 50 or even 60 kilometers per second at the time of observation. That makes the observation window very short. And that's going to change, we think, with the use of new assets, the Pan-STARRS-2, for example, LSST, as Meg presented earlier. So, for example, Pan-STARRS-2 recently, actually, I can't remember which it was, but there was a recent discovery of long-tailed comets detected in 2017. It's called C2017 K2. By looking at the archive Actually, it was pre-recovered in the archives of 2013 when it was 25 AU away from its perihelion. So in the future, if we can detect objects 25 AU away or about 10 to 13 years to perihelion, it becomes easier to plan mission. And that's basically the principle, the hope for future exploration of long-period comets. The situation is more difficult in the case of interstellar objects because they are smaller. But I mean, we think based on a sample of one, but also they don't have, also based on a sample of one, they don't show outgassing activity. And same thing for the next comet. So it's way more difficult to prepare for the exploration of interstellar objects. Other challenges is that the orbital properties can cover a very broad range of inclinations. That's the most complicated aspect. The long-period comets come with a lot of outgassing close to perihelion, which makes their encounter very intensive, very risky. And yeah, in the case of IS-2 advanced, they're just too, we detect them too late with the current set of ground-based capabilities. So Halley's Comet is not a long-period comet, it's what we call a longer period comet with a period of 76 years. But it's very representative of in terms of what we would like to accomplish in the future. It has a very high inclination, about 162 degrees with respect to the ecliptic. And the velocities at the time of encounter with Giotto, for example, in the 1986 or 7 was 68 kilometers per second. The energy involved in the oh, I see, you can have better. The energy involved in the encounter was so intensive that there was a micrograin impact that entirely destabilized the spacecraft, and they lost altitude control for a few hours. So. And at the time, there was a contest for kids to represent how they would see, how they were envisioning the encounter of Giotto with Halley. And you can see, we knew it was going to be a very violent event with a splash everywhere and a splash of paint everywhere. And I think that is really representative of what an encounter with a long-period comet is going to be. A lot of dust, gas, and very intensive event. So something that is very important with exploration of Halley's Comet and should be a template for future exploration of long-period objects is the fact that there was a coordinated international exploration with Russia, JAXA. The United States participated, but they had some failure, and the Giotto spacecraft from ESA was the one that got the most data. But the JAXA probe were launched early on to provide information that would help inform the Giotto observations. And that's a very nice example of how we could, in the future, use multiple spacecraft to optimize operations at challenging targets. So we've been doing a bunch of mission design for that study. I'm just showing one example here, and there will be more in the report in June. We've looked at, what if we wanted to build a spacecraft very fast and encounter C2017 K2, because it's going to cross for the ecliptic in July 2022 at about 1.8 AU from the sun. And so we looked at a situation where we would launch with a C3 of about 150 kilometers squared per second squared, so very standard high. And first we thought that we would be able to cross with the comet at the ecliptic, but the problem is that it's just in 6 months, we had 6 months launching in February 2022. We had only 6 months to cross it in July 2022. So we thought it's never going to happen, not even under the SIMPLEX program, for example. So an alternative is to just launch in 2022 in the body to Jupiter and just.
You just
That's right.
On the microphone.
Encounter. with the comet after experience that would be in 2035. Some things to keep in mind that it's feasible, it just takes a long time. It's not clear that this could work under a program like SIMPLEX using small sats. But it's just one example of comets that for which we have an early detection, and there may be many more in the future. So in the study, we looked a lot at what would be the advantage of using many spacecraft, like in the context of Halley, but using more modern technologies and coordination among spacecraft. So there are many aspects, and it's not big news, but there is just the aspect of redundancy. You deploy many spacecraft in hazardous environments, you have block redundancy that maybe increases your chance of getting results. You can perform observations under multiple vantage points, for example, looking at outgassing. We had a big interest from the group for impacting, doing a deep impact style investigation. So we launch an impactor, and then we have an armada of spacecraft looking at the result of the impact, especially in the case of the Manx comet. We were hoping that the impact could be volatile, and we have an opportunity to maybe sample with mass spectrometer or the spectrometer. And we also looked at scenarios where we could retrieve some materials with scouts that bring the material back to the mothership. And that is getting really challenging in terms of autonomy, but you know, maybe looking 20 years ahead, that could be a feasibility. How am I doing on time?
Wrap up.
Yeah, okay. So I think there is a good prospect that we can accomplish this mission with a lot of small spacecraft instead of a big monolithic spacecraft in the future because of all the recent developments in small instruments. Now we have small dust spectrometer from JAXA, magnetometer imager. We have a bunch of things going on that will be in the presentation. But also we had the success of MARCO, the Mars Cube 1, which was a really exceptional in terms of sending spacecraft, CubeSat for the first time. They worked perfectly well. They did the relay within sight. They introduced the reflector ray, demonstrated the array radio for CubeSats. So now we can use that radio with more confidence in future CubeSat missions. And JPL is developing more antennas and propulsion. Propulsion remains a big there is a gap right now between what we can do in a CubeSat and what is available in terms of technology. And we think that there will be a big need for autonomy and coordination. And since Tim is going to talk about the workshop on autonomy tomorrow, I'm just going to pass and just summarize. So I think we all agree in the community that these once-in-a-lifetime targets are very interesting from a science standpoint. There is a fair chance that they will be highlighted in the decadal survey, or we should highlight them in the decadal survey, our community. Upcoming ground-based assets will allow detection of long-period objects, at least the long-period comets, more than 10 years before perihelion, which could help prepare for future missions. But there is a big issue from a programmatic standpoint about advocating, for example, for the exploration of interstellar objects if we don't know how many are out there, if we cannot really plan for their exploration. And so we need to, and we keep, as part of that key study, we keep brainstorming about the best way to approach interstellar objects in particular. And we think so a finding from this study is that by using small sats and benefiting from our leveraging development investment in small instruments and subsystems, that it would become possible to observe and explore these objects with a lot of small spacecraft. And I think that's it. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. We have questions?
How far were you when you were intercepting the comet? How far in terms of EU? Just because when you're thinking about a lot of these multi-spacecraft concepts, one of the biggest issues for those little CubeSats is power.
Yeah,
so it looks like we're intercepting it pretty far.
Yeah, so the question was, how far away was the intercept on that intercept of long period comets because if it's small spacecraft, power is often an issue.
Yeah, especially your the 2017 K2 at 14 years after perihelion, it was very far. It was 25 AU.
Yeah.
So we can think about choosing maybe radioisotopes, or that should be okay. But telecom is going to remain always a decision.
Yeah. No, I mean the IRS radio is fantastic, but it doesn't.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so CubeSats are not going to be CubeSats are not going to be the asset of choice for the type of exploration.
Okay.
There are lots of smaller radios that are coming online, more efficient antennas, and so it just I would say for that particular concept we looked at, we're talking about the 500 kilograms for example.
Okay, thank you. So coming up next is the